Hi, and welcome back to another episode with It's Dr. Dan, and today we're going to be looking at gases. So, why so much on gases? Well, the whole idea about this particular subject is that gases are one of the three major phases of matter. So, and what makes them really important is that unlike solids and liquids, the molecules of gas, they're spread really far apart, and that means that they have very minimal intermolecular force interactions. So there's really not a lot of hydrogen bonding, not a lot of dipole-dipole dispersion. So it makes it an ideal system for chemists and physicists to be able to study to see how does the most simple molecules exist? How do they behave with one another when they interact with one another? Especially when you kind of compare these different images that I prepared up here. When you look at a solid, it's all being held together very, very tightly. Liquids are a little bit farther apart. They have interactions. It makes it extremely complex to understand. Gases are far apart. It is a simpler system. So, the big idea with these is that gases, they move independently of one another. They just bounce all over the place like a bunch of billiard balls. So what are some common examples of this? How can I illustrate this for you? Let's dive in. So gases are all around us. We see a lot of different common gases that you're going to come across in chemical reactions and trying to identify some of these. There are a couple that are really quick and easy to find on your periodic table. For example, the first few is just when you're looking at noble gases. So that last column of the periodic table, starting with helium down to xenon, these are all that's in its name, noble gas. Those are some of the most common ones that you'll see. You also have the diatomic gases. An easy mnemonic to remember the diatomic gases is have no fear of ice cold beer. So if with that one, it's H2, N2, F2, O2, I2, Cl2, and Br2 for all the diatomics. And a diatomic gas is that there's always seven of them. So they're with these seven gases, they are always binding to themselves. So they are a notorious seven. You'll always see these seven together. So whenever hydrogen is produced as a product, it's always going to be as H2 gas. If oxygen is being produced as a product, it's going to be O2 gas. This is extremely important for chemical reactions. So I would recommend writing those down for yourself because you will see them be produced. There are a lot of other common molecular gases that we see in our everyday lives too. For example, you currently right now are breathing, which I hope, right? So you're breathing in air, which is oxygen, nitrogen, the diatomics, and what comes out of you when you exhale. Well, things like CO2, for example. You might, if you ever come across some other gases, let's say if you ever cook, you might use propane gas if you cook with a gas burner at home. There are a lot of other gases that come across, like, for example, with ammonia, sometimes it's produced with cleaning products. These are different gases that we come across in our regular everyday lives. So it comes in molecular, atomic, and diatomic form. We see it all the time. So how do we go about measuring these? So when it comes to units of measurement, so over here on the left-hand side, there are four major things that we're going to be looking at when measuring them. There's volume, temperature, the amount, so moles, and pressure. So these are all things that are somehow they can be actually looked at in the lab. They are different things that are measurable. So volume, you could capture a gas, you can measure its volume. If you think of your tires, for example, for your car, you might measure the pressure of those tires to make sure that they are at the right levels. You can measure the temperature of the room that you are currently in to see, is it cold, is it hot? These are going to affect the gases. The amount or moles is how much are you breathing in. If you think of a balloon, for example, and you start with that balloon, it's empty, right? There's no moles of gas in it. But once you start blowing into it, it gets bigger and bigger and bigger. You are adding moles of gas to it. That's one of the big ideas. So with gases, they are all around you right now, right? There's a homogeneous mixture of gases around you as you are sitting here. You have oxygen, nitrogen, CO2, all the gases all around you. These gases, what they are doing is they are exhibiting a pressure on you as a result. So that is atmospheric pressure, meaning that all the gases on Earth are pushing down on you. They are being pulled down by gravity, meaning that if you are at sea level right now, then the air is much denser up here or down here. Versus if you go up into the mountains, let's say if you start going hiking and you go into like Yosemite or Yellowstone or any of these national parks, the mountains are really high. It might get a little harder to breathe. Yes, you might be doing some cardio, but realistically, the air is a lot thinner too. And that's because the atmospheric pressure decreases as you go up. So we're going to be using a couple different things as well that are some standards. So yes, you have pressure and volume and these different units. And for a lot of these, what we're going to be looking at is when we are measuring them, we want to stick into four common units. You always want your volume to be in liters, temperature to be in Kelvin, moles and moles, and pressure for atmospheres. And there's many different units that can be used, but for these videos, we're going to stick to these four. Now, when it comes to standardized pressure and temperature, so STP, this is always referring to 273 Kelvin, so if you think of the Celsius conversion term, and at one atmosphere or 760 millimeters of mercury. So why is that important? Well, what does that mean? What is pressure? Well, when it comes to pressure, the whole idea is that we take something like a barometer, which is over here on the left-hand side. Now, what is actually happening here is that you have air pushing against a liquid surface. So if I have a dish here, it is full of mercury. Mercury is a liquid metal. Now, when air is pushing down on this surface, it's causing the mercury in the tube to stay inside of it. Now, if the pressure's changing, if there's like a rainstorm coming in or a weather front changing, this level here is going to change, going up and down just by little amounts. And that all has to do with the atmospheric pressure pushing against it. So gravity is pushing the liquid down, and the atmospheric pressure is trying to push it up. So when that happens, the forces are pushing against each other, which is how we read our pressure every day. So in lab, it might be really common where you have to use a barometer to try to do some simple conversions. So how do we do these conversions? Let's practice it. So this is something that's a basic dimensional analysis conversion. So when you are going through these, you're going to set up just a little T table for yourself. So what we're given is it asks us to convert 728 millimeters of mercury to atmospheres. So what we're going to do is we're going to write down our given piece of information, and we're going to illustrate that for ourselves. So we have 728 millimeters of mercury. And how do we convert that to atmospheres? Well, for this one, the common conversion is that 760 millimeters of mercury is equal to one atmosphere. So how would we set this up? Well, it's about canceling units. They have to be opposite of one another. So we will put the 760 millimeters of mercury on the bottom. That's going to cancel out. One atmosphere is going to go on the top, and that's going to help us cancel that one out as well. Now, that's going to leave us with our units that are left. Now, when we go through this, what you're going to get, so you're going to take 728, divide it by 760 to get your final answer, and you'll get a pretty big number. You'll get 0.95789. Now, is that the right way to show it? Well, we got to count sig figs. So being that this one started with 1, 2, 3 sig figs, we got to round it to 3 sig figs. So we'll round it to the third spot. So it's going to be 958 atmospheres. And that's going to be our answer for this one. That's how you convert. Let's do it one more time for ourselves. So if I want to convert 1.27 atmospheres, 2 millimeters of mercury, how would I do that? Well, once again, we're going to illustrate the important piece of information, right? We see that we have the 1.27 atmospheres, and we're going to set that up as well in a table for ourselves. We're going to use the same conversions. So in this case, we're going to put atmospheres opposite. So when we do that, we can set it up where atmospheres cancels atmospheres. And what we're going to have is 760 millimeters of mercury. It's leaving that unit for us, which is exactly what we want. So we'll take 1.27 times it by 760. And what you are going to get is 965 millimeters of mercury as your answer. All right. So this talks about a lot about measurements, how to look at these different gases. But what else can we show? How can we talk about how they're going to function? Well, the way that gases are behaving has to do with something called kinetic molecular theory, which describes exactly how they are going to work. So I have some little demonstrations that I took from an open online source to help show you, see how they function, so you can understand how these are acting like little billiard balls. So when we are looking at kinetic molecular theory, this describes how gases are in constant random motion. So they're just moving all over the place. They are bouncing into all these different things, going all over the place, and they are constantly moving. They don't stop. Now, the second thing is, these things are moving in a straight line. When they hit something, they reflect and go back. So they continuously keep moving. They are like, if you have a pool table and you have the little billiard balls, they're bouncing all over the place. They're not just stopping for anything. So because of that, these particles are really tiny. There's a lot of empty space in between them. So they're always going to be colliding and moving. So when they collide, will they lose energy? We assume that they don't, that they are like elastic. They're like rubber. When they hit, they bounce. There's no energy being transferred. So we like to think of these as an ideal system, something that's easy for us to study, to see, can we explain what we are observing with our own eyes? So when we are seeing that, what that allows us to do is that energy is kinetic energy, the energy of movement, right? This is constant motion. So because of that motion, that's all related directly to temperature. So I'm going to show that to you, is how that can be shown. So how can we talk about that in terms of collisions? Well, the whole idea is that when you have these different things, that the more that the temperature is increasing, the more that these are going to be colliding. So if I show you my first example here, and I have a little particle, so I only have three particles, they are slowly bouncing. This is at room temperature. So three little gas particles bouncing around. Now, if I start to heat it up, now they're getting a lot of energy. They're going to move faster and a lot more, and they're going to be colliding with all the walls. As they collide with the walls, that's the pressure that we are talking about, right? They're confined to a specific volume. We have five particles that are here, and they are continuously going through this motion. Now, if I take another example, let's say I introduce 200 particles, not just five, but a lot of them. On this one, the one thing that we're gonna be noticing is how much collisions we're gonna be having. So when I bring this up, you're gonna see that they're colliding with each other. They're colliding with the walls. They are randomly going in every single direction. They are constantly hitting each other, the walls. And when I start to heat it up, it's like a free-for-all mayhem, but they're not attaching to each other. They're just bouncing and continuously moving. Now, even though it's really hot, what happens if I start to cool it down and go through that entire process where I make it a little bit colder, right, with the little ice cubes that are there? Notice how they're slowing down. They're less energy. It's like a turtle moving. And because of that, they almost start to become like they're drifting in space, which this is kind of how space behaves. They're just particles floating around. So whether you're heating something up or you're cooling it down, this is an idea of how particles are exactly working. All right. So next time in the next video, I'm going to be looking at at the different gas laws, so we can go through the mathematics of understanding. But this was a short video on how gases behave, how they work. I hope this gave you an idea of what to expect for your future classes. And this has been Dr. Dan. Please consider hitting that like and subscribe button. I really appreciate all your support, everybody. I'll see y'all later. Bye.